Hey everybody, Reid here. Welcome to a gameplay video here on ChannelFireball.com. Today I am playing, you guessed it, New Standard with March of the Machine, and the deck that I have in front of me is Grixis Midrange. Now before I talk about the deck, I do want to remind you that you can read more about this deck, including in-depth deck guide, sideboard guide, with the CFB Pro subscription. That's all part of the larger TCG player subscription, which gives you benefits on your orders, your shipping, everything like that. Thanks also to Ultimate Guard for helping make this content possible. Ultimate Guard just announced that they are now producing their Boulder deck boxes at varying locations internationally, which should both increase the accessibility to customers all over the world. That includes, you know, us United States-based customers. And it also further improves their sustainability initiative with cutting down on, you know, supply chain shipping type stuff. So great job, Ultimate Guard, and thanks also to them for sponsoring me and my teammates. All right, so Grixis Midrange. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about the structure of the deck, because if you've played a lot of Standard in pretty much the last, you know, 6 months or a year, you're going to know what Grixis Midrange is all about. But I do want to talk about a few new cards that I've sprinkled in. The one I'd say that's most impressed me in the early days of New Standard is Hidetsugu and Kairi. Just big, awesome dragon with an enters the battlefield card advantage ability. And then if you can get this dies trigger, like sometimes you're really hammering the opponent. It's super good with Invoke Despair. I'm even trying out one of this Breach the Multiverse in the sideboard. I don't know if I'll get to live the dream in this video of casting that for free off Hidetsugu and Kairi, but you never know. Got to try it if you want it to happen. Other cards sprinkled in from the new set. Invasion of Kaldheim. This is just sort of like a pet card of mine. It's really fun. I've been playing it as like a one of in a lot of my red decks. What is nice in this deck in particular is that a single attack from Reckoner Bankbuster threatens to transform it. So opponents got to take it seriously. One pile on, just kind of round out the removal suite, kills Shouldred, kills artifact creatures, whatever you need. Speaking of Shouldred, I have two of the old version and one of the new version. And then in my sideboard, I have Invasion of Karsis, which has taken the spot of Brotherhood's End, Vampire's Vengeance, whatever it might be. And then I have three copies of Lithomantic Barrage, which this might be the single most important addition to Grixis, as just a really efficient removal spell that can help you keep pace against those Thalia, Rafine, Adeline type decks. All right, so that's Grixis. Let's play it through a Standard League. I'll be honest with you, it's been quite a while since I've chosen to play Standard on Magic Online, but let's have some fun. It's not a lot of active players in the Standard League. I think it is the case that many people who choose to play Standard choose to play on Magic Arena, but I'm just firing up good old-fashioned Magic Online for today. That's not a good hand. There's way too much converted mana cost. Much better. So I think I want to keep my three lands, the two creatures, and then, you know, I could bottom the Invoke Despair with the logic of just this is my most expensive card, or I could bottom the Make Disappear thinking that I have curve outs in my early turns anyway. And that's what I'll do. Bottom Make Disappear. Play the Haunted Ridge on turn one so that I can play Darkslick Shores and get the Painless Harvester. All right, mono white. It's a big matchup in Standard, perhaps the biggest matchup in Standard of Grixis against white.
Yeah, so
Wrecker Bankbuster, just one of the best cards in the format in general, one of the best against Grixis, one of the best in Grixis. So potentially a decent start for the opponent. I could see game one being tough. You know, it's a hard matchup. They're on the play with a good draw. And, you know, before I get those extra targeted removal spells in, I might struggle. Excuse me. Cats are fighting in here. All right, so next turn they're going to get a little jump in mana. I wonder what I should do. Like, I could just play the Corpse Appraiser. Just this 3-mana 3/3 to get some board presence. I don't know if I really want to use the blood. I guess I could save the blood, try to draw another creature. It's tough. I think on balance, I'm just going to play this just to spend my mana. It's a little mopey, but let's see if that plan works out. I guess that's the thing about Corpse Appraiser is you're so used to seeing it when it gets that awesome, like, full value triggered ability, but 3-mana for a 3/3 is just fine. Like, Graveyard Trespasser would be not much better on this board. Alright, so they did not choose to use the second chapter. They just played the planes from their hand. Kind of makes sense, like, the fact that they played two colorless lands this early on suggests maybe that they didn't have another planes, and that could be a reason why they would choose not to use Chapter 2, because they'd rather just play the land from their hand untapped. Oh no, my blood token. I needed that. At least it's a creature that can't crew the Bankbuster and can't rumble with the Corpse Appraiser. But my hand is not good. Like, missing this play here is really quite a big deal, and it also reflects the early mulligan, right? Like, I could have had Make Disappear for either this turn or the previous turn, but I had to bottom that after the mulligan. Also, I kept three lands in my opening hand, and just every draw step has been a land so far. We are not exactly firing on all cylinders here. So they're going to lose the human token, they're going to lose either the architect or the wedding announcement, their choice, and then I'm going to draw a card. He's like, could have attacked there. It's not obvious if I should or not, because the Corpse Appraiser does hold off the Lauren, and then that's, like, relevant against the wedding announcement's ability, so who knows. The Glory Dominus. If one or more tokens be created under control, create double, and then you can make it indestructible. Got it. Okay, wedding announcement down. That's at least a tiny bit of good news. Pretty scary because these, you know, they've still got the Bank Buster, they still have these Roadside Reliquaries, so my opponent's never really going to run out of gas here. All right, Corpse Appraiser with still no creatures in the graveyard. Anything I can do to get a Lauren or a Mondrak in the graveyard? Suicide the Corpse Appraiser. All right. I'm going to start with Bank Buster and activate. Okay. All right. I'm satisfied. I found a good play to make even in the absence of that Corpse Appraiser. And then possibly I can use Chapter 2 to discard a creature and then set myself up. Is there anything I can do to get it to kill an indestructible creature? I probably just have to like try to outclass it, but I think it's quite unlikely that I'm going to win this game at this point. Elspeth Resplendent. This can give lifelink, right? Yeah, can put a lifelink counter on something. So making an indestructible lifelinker. Yeah, that's a problem. All right, so here's my draw step. The Bank Buster, with the Fable trigger on the stack, I could draw a card with the Bank Buster. I could also use Pile On, that destroys Elspeth, which is pretty nice. Okay, I'll just discard these two Shivan Reefs. Two lands, no help. So now if I can pile on and try to surveil something into the graveyard. And so much stuff in the graveyard, and yet still no target for the Corpse Appraiser. Go for the throat. Five, nine. Yeah, I mean, it really feels like I'm just gonna be dead. I think I'm gonna pack this one in. Just fully outclassed there. Oh man, a difficult. I think a lot of these matchups are going to be difficult to sideboard for. Let me see if I can pull up Andrea Mengucci's sideboard guide on ChannelFireball.com. So my deck list, of course, is not the same as his, but it can still be a good reference. So he suggests sprinkling in Duress, Negate, Blade Coil Serpent. Soul Transfer, and he cuts Go for the, or he trims on Go for the Throat. Seems like Cut Down is going to be a lot weaker than the Lithomantic Barrage. I don't even know if I want the full number of Lithomantic Barrages for that, for what that's worth. I do like a Braid, with just because Reckoner Bankbuster is so important. Trims on Corpse Appraiser, that does kind of make sense to me. What else can we do here? I think I like Pylon and Soul Transfer because they kill Planeswalkers. Lithomantic Barrage also kills Planeswalkers, so that's probably fine. Hidetsugu and Kairi are pretty likely to just meet an exile-based removal spell. So maybe that's less than ideal. All right, one Corpse Appraiser and three Blood Tithe Harvesters. Sure. I will start with Reckoner Bankbuster. Doesn't seem like this is worth casting Lithomantic Barrage on. Yep, Lauren of the third path, excellent against the Bank Buster. I guess I'll just draw before deciding what to do with the blood token. All right, another Bank Buster. So I can barrage the Lauren and attack and play another Bank Buster. It's like pretty embarrassing if they just have another copy of Lauren, but I think I think I want to use my mana rather than like playing around cards that they may or may not have. All right, come on, no more Lorens. Need this Bank Buster to get me up to 7 mana for my Breach the Multiverse. Interesting. Well, I guess I'll attack with the Bank Buster and just play the Fable. Some temptation to draw a card with the Bank Buster because it's like so good for me if I draw a land to play the Fable. But I think I want to make sure to just continue adding to my board presence. There's the Glory Dominus. And enough mana to make it indestructible. So there goes all my aggressive potential. But Invoke Despair is excellent here, potentially, as long as this Plains doesn't represent a surge of righteousness. So, how do I want to handle this? I guess just discard the barrage. Because these two are both too important for what I'm trying to accomplish here. Okay. Come on, no surge of righteousness, please. Hey, it worked. another enchantment I can take care of with my next invoke. Sure. I guess in theory I can kill Mondrak with Blood Tithe Harvester. So wait a minute. This thing is not currently indestructible, right? Like, this is, they're just fully offering me a trade? I think I would like to oblige. Not indestructible. No mana available. Yeah, let's trade. All right, and then another invoke, only taking care of a human token, but then they'll choose to either sacrifice the ossification or the restoration of Iganjo. Right, and sorry, I confused myself. I thought the ossification was on the Blood Tithe Harvester, but it was on the Fable token, so they did a good job there insulating themselves against Invoke. But the hits keep coming. I have a pretty powerful hand here. Yeah, I'll just pass and see what happens. They can discard a card to bring back Ossification if they so choose. Five life, by the way, it's not a lot. All right, they just discarded ossification to get it back at no mana cost. Good news is that if I can kill it, I get my full Fable of the Mirror Breaker back. Okay. So Invoke's going to kill Human Token, Restoration, and Eternal Wanderer. Alternatively, I could Barrage the Eternal Wanderer, which will result in me drawing another card, my opponent losing another two life. Is that worth it? So basically, like, I get to cycle this and deal two damage to the opponent. Yeah, I think I'm into that, like, especially because I'm cycling to try to get my seventh land. And then when I cast this, there's some juicy targets out there, including Eternal Wanderer, Mondrak, Lauren. And hopefully I'll mill something from my own graveyard in the top 10. Okay, I like my opponent's plan there, getting the lifelink from the seasoned Cathar. They have some very real pressure on me as well. Okay, so let's discard this Black Cleave Cliffs. And breach the multiverse. The key here is that I need to mill something myself to feel good about my position. Oh, baby. So I milled Shouldred, which forces them to sacrifice a non-token creature or planeswalker. And then I can take Wandering Emperor, Sanctuary Warden, Elspeth Resplendent, Eternal Wanderer. Let's think about this. Give my Goblin Shaman plus one in flying. I can Lauren to kill the architect and then attack uncontested. Can't go too wrong with Sanctuary Warden. Man, just don't want to make a mistake here. I'm gonna say that I can't go wrong with Sanctuary Warden. Well, they could have like Farewell. They could have a creature sweeper that exiles everything. Even then, I'm not really in that bad shape. Yeah. All right, Sanctuary Warden and Shouldred, please. They didn't mill any board sweepers, so like maybe their post-sideboard configuration does not include them. Pretty sweet. Also, how the Breach the Multiverse just already sets you up with eight cards to flip to Shouldred. Maybe this card is just really good. Okay, that's a good sign for me. A little bit of desperation from the opponent, just cycling the roadside reliquary. Okay, ossification. All right, I think we're going for the true scriptures here. 5 mana at sorcery speed. I don't want to attack because then I could lose her in combat. The true scriptures. So then next turn, they'll have to discard their hand. I'm protecting with negate. Chapter 3 is like definitely going to be all over. Block. The human token, chump the samurai. Wandering Emperor, do I care about this? Yeah, I'll just go ahead and negate that. All right. So that's definitely a plan, you know, getting up to breach the multiverse or true scriptures. Anything more I want to change here? I don't think I need more spot removal. The invasion of Karsis can sometimes wind up being good if they have a lot of farmhands and wedding announcements. But I think I'm mostly okay with the configuration I have. So breach the multiverse. It's always tough because this is the type of card where it is really expensive itself, and then it makes you want to put additional really expensive cards in your deck. It's like, oh yeah, I'll just have breach the multiverse with, you know, Shouldred and Hidetsugu and Itali Primal Conqueror. But you know, at a certain point, it's like, wow, I can't just have all cards that cost 5, 6, and 7 mana in my deck. Even Chandra, can you imagine Chandra like doubling the effect of this? And then I'll have the cruelty of Gix so I can search for my Breach the Multiverse. But yeah, just more big expensive cards. But this that does seem like a decent plan against white. Like you kind of need to go over the top of them in some way. I'm going to keep this and just really hope that I draw my third land on time. Uh-oh, these have not been good first two draw steps. I really need to get this Fable out. Rattle off a couple of lands. Steel Seraph. It is white, so, you know, I could try to let it resolve, but I think I need to just use my mana and draw that third land. That's the plan here. Come on, let's go. Yes, we've done it. All right, so unfortunately this land enters the battlefield tapped, though I may have an uncontested attack with the goblin. Feels like I want to discard one Shouldred and possibly the barrage as well. Yeah, let's do that. Bunch of lands entering the battlefield tapped. All right, I'm just going to play the Harvester and a tapped land and save my treasure. And then guarantee that I'll have Invoke Despair for the next two turns. Once again, like, I was fortunate that they didn't have Surge of Righteousness last game, but that is a real risk in a post-sideboard game against white, that they could just have the one. This is, by the way, I hope I have the correct name, but this is a one white instant uncommon from the new set, and it gives you hexproof, and it prevents all the damage from red and black sources. So one way that I could maybe kill that Mondrak is if I'm able to copy Blood Tithe Harvester, then I'll have two bloods. I can give it -4/-4. All right, here goes nothing. Yes, it worked. Then, like, say I attack, they block with Mondrak, then I give it -2/-2, then they sack two tokens. Yeah, that's not a great play for me. But they have to do something about this board state. They cannot allow me to untap with Reflection of Kiki Jiki. So then hopefully it's like if they're spending removal on this, that's less removal that they're going to have for Shouldred at a later time. What are they thinking about? They might be thinking about just end of turn going for the indestructible, because then they want to tap out. Okay. So maybe make Mondrak indestructible, then tap out for the Elspeth, give it the lifelink counter. That was pretty effective for them last time. But I could still kill it with double Blood Tithe Harvester. That's the thing. So let's see. They've got to have something pretty special here, I think. Main phase, Wandering Emperor, put a counter on Mondrak. Why? Okay, to play around a counterspell? So look, if they don't have Surge of Righteousness, this kind of lights out. Like, I can just kill the farmhand and then invoke Despair their whole board. And yeah, I guess I'm going to try that. Oh, but unfortunately, I might have to suicide attack the goblin to make that work. So alternatively, I could just use both on the Mondrak. That's probably better, because then if they have the Surge of Righteousness, they'll have a lot of pressure to go for it. So kill the Mondrak, attack with the Goblin Shaman. Love it. So now I'm sort of ahead on every axis. Like, I'm ahead on the board. I'm ahead in cards in hand. I'm ahead on life total. Opponent still main phasing things to play around permission spells. Also get that reflection out of there. So if I make this, can I spend 4 red on this? Because if I can, then I have lethal. No, I'd have to spend 6 red on it, which I cannot do. So it looks like probably just attack the Emperor. Well, look, we want red, red, blue, blue, black, black. They'll kind of clean my opponent out. Discard the last card, then Goblin Shaman attacks Emperor. Blade Coil Serpent attacks player. Attack Emperor, and then invoke Despair for lethal.
Yeah. I know. Yeah, no. So I really appreciate it. These are the things I really do need to know.
Ooh, that was a marathon of a first match. I'll be back for match 2. All right, I'm back for match number 2 with standard Grixis. Let's do it. Yeah, I can work with this. I need to find red mana, but in the meantime, I can play Reckoner Bankbuster. So not too bad. Crawling Chorus. All right. resilient to my removal spells. I did find a Black Cleave Cliff, so do I want to just fire off Blood Tithe Harvester? I think so. I think this is going to be a matchup that moves fast, and the Bank Buster is just a little bit clunky. Right, so I imagine I'm harvestering the Rot Priest. And then I guess play Fable. Could cut down the Skrelv and play Bank Buster, but I think I want to play a 3-mana card right now. So this is a bit of a shields down moment. My opponent can make their creature unblockable. They can pump it up. Though I guess pumping creatures is like, it's toxic as distinct from infect. So it's not like I'm going to die out of nowhere. All right, the Bloated Contaminator. Can't cut that down. Can it eventually attempt to block it with a Bank Buster? What exactly do I want to do here? I guess just discard the Shivan Reef. And then plan to do Corpse Appraiser and cut down the Skrelv. Do I discard the Bank Buster? I don't think so. Gonna take another cut down. All right, do your worst. No attacks, that's a good sign for me. Then I feel like if my opponent can't do something pretty special this turn, then I run away with it with the Reflection or the Bank Buster. All Skrelves all the time. Now I can just, basically never put the shields down, draw 4 cards per turn. Skrelv does not help to get through Reckoner Bankbusters, which is important. I started by saying like, oh, the Bank Buster is going to be really clunky in this matchup, but then all of a sudden having a colorless blocker was crucial. All right, let's see what old Menguchi has to say about the Infect Toxic matchup. Spring in all the removal spells and cut expensive cards. Makes sense. I guess Invoke Despair is like really crummy against Crawling Chorus. Duress is probably fine. Soul Transfer. Lithomantic Barrage. Braid. Yeah, just like everything that kills a creature. Try to find room for one duress at the expense of. I don't particularly want to cut any of these cards. I mean, maybe the third Bank Buster. Is it possible I just have too much removal? Okay, so I have a really good six card hand, basically just keeping the five cards on the left, and then I kind of like the big Shouldred more than the little Shouldred in this matchup. Let's try it. The Seed Core. Okay, so this is like basically a Pendlehaven. Yep. So it makes me take more damage, makes the creatures harder to block, doesn't deal more poison counters, thankfully. So the Fable is going to throw a 2-2 blocker into the mix, and then hopefully I get to see three new cards for next turn to find something to play. Oh boy. Ooh, Menace. So interesting. An Abzan Toxic deck. This does not have Toxic itself, but it does just boost all these other creatures. I can't block. I'm now corrupted. Soul Transfer. Permanently exile something. Probably want to take out the Slaughter Singer. So, like, attack. Soul Transfer the Slaughter Singer and then play a Blood Tithe Harvester. Looks okay to me. Okay. Skrelv's Hive. Yeah, that's good against me. I think I'm on board for blocking. Maybe I'll just take it and then I can use this to kill the Grafted Butcher. Probably a little better. Could also try to keep it around for the reflection combo. Feel like if we get to that point, I'm gonna be just fine. Yeah, all right. I'm gonna go kill the butcher, attack for two, play Shouldred, and play land. There's nothing super special about, making my opponent sacrifice a crawling chorus, but I'm gonna have to fight through that eventually. And now they really just don't have much in the way of attackers. And with no real board presence and just two lands, I can probably pressure my opponent's life total enough that the Skrelv's Hive won't overwhelm me. This game, I'm not close to making the true scriptures, so probably just gonna have to plan to win with good old-fashioned damage. Right, evil has been destroyed. I will block. Corpse Appraiser. I like that. Get that Grafted Butcher since that does have an ability from the graveyard. And I'll just set another Corpse Appraiser in my hand. That seed core is actually fairly nasty, especially with the lifelink from Skrelv's Hive. I think I'm supposed to keep blocking, just keep my life total high while I get my card advantage engines going. I did board out Invoke Despair and a lot of my top end. So what's the end game here? I find Shouldered the Apocalypse, or I set up Reflection again. Invasion of Karsus, probably actually not what I want in this situation. Yeah, just because I think my own creatures are too valuable right now. I'll just take an Abrade. The good news is, with the seed core, they only get to pump one creature, so they can't really attack two 1/1s into two blockers, because then, you know, I'll win at least one of those fights. Is there any way I'm supposed to just take this? Yeah, I'll take it just this one time. So down to 6 life and up to 7 poison. Rot Priest, all right. So what do I think my opponent's last card is? If it's a protection spell of some kind, then if I go target your creature, they go target it with a protection spell, I go target your creature again, I'll just die to the Rot Priest's ability. So I wonder if like removal spells are kind of not what I want at this point. And just go wide with blockers. All right, well, that's definitely not ideal, but I do get to continue cycling next turn. How much can I afford to attack with here? Probably nothing. though maybe like one goblin. I am surprised and impressed that I'm actually like probably going to lose this game. I thought I was just totally in the driver's seat, but the combination of the Skrelv's Hive and the Seed Core has really impressed. So my hand is bad, but if I get to survive this turn, then I get three more card draws and I get to flip the Fable. Oh no. All right, yeah, I think I made a lot of, you know, bad decisions here. And at this point, I'm dead to just to both toxic and damage. GG. Okay, so for game three, I'm going to cut the duress. I think there's just too much risk of that missing. I could see wanting like the Blade Coil Serpent or an Invoke Despair. And maybe just have a little bit too much removal. I don't know if my opponent's leaving in Bloated Processor after sideboarding, but this is one of my only ways to deal with it. Maybe I'll just cut in a Braid. It's a good classic hand. I might even be able to beat down my opponent in some ways. I think my big mistake in that game was I should have just not blocked the first time with my Reflection of Kiki Jiki. Like if I had taken the first hit from the Seed Core plus the Skrelv's Hive, then I could have like gotten a little traction with the Reflection. As it turned out, I later drew Corpse Appraiser, so that would have been a great combo. So I do think that game was winnable, and I played I guess the term is too conservatively, like blocking too early instead of trying to get ahead with my creatures. All right, Skrelv's Hive, nice and early. Difference is, I have a lot more pressure this time, and we're not close to the lifelink ability, so I'm hoping to just be the you know, Rakdos beatdown deck this time. Okay, Bloated Contaminator. I'm gonna have to kill that with a Blood Tithe Harvester. No other way around it. Okay. Alright, I regret my choice. I wish I had killed the Slaughter Singer before combat. This is not like a normal Lord, it's a triggered ability, so once the trigger goes off, you can't kill the Slaughter Singer. But end of turn, I'll go for cycling one of these lands. Bank Buster can be good here. So what my opponent really wants is to target the Venerated Rock Priest, which would give me a third poison counter and turn on the lifelink. But even then, they could maybe only go up to 8 life, and then attacking with a Bank Buster and a Harvester puts them to 1 and dead to Skrelv's Hive. So it's dicey situation. There's another Slaughter Singer. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't want to target something because that gives the lifelink right away. So if my opponent has nothing, they're super dead to the Shouldred, but I also could have just killed this, crewed this, attacked, put you to 1, and then you die to the Skrelv's Hive. But as it stands, I am just gonna attack with everything. Maybe this is still bad. Can I die to like a giant growth here? Some kind of way to pump the Rot Priest? I probably still should have made the play that I was going to make, which is killing the Rot Priest pre-combat. But looks like my opponent didn't have any instants, and I was able to win. That was not a pretty match. I'm not super thrilled with the way I played it, but I do advance to 2-0, so I'll see you for the next match. Hey everybody, welcome back for match number 3 with standard Grixis. I'm on the draw with a hand that needs to find blue mana, but I'm going to keep it. 2 lands and a 2 drop on the draw. Sounds a-okay to me. And Seachrome Coast. Probably most likely to reflect Esper Legends, but we could have Soldiers, we could have an Azorius Control deck, we could have a Brew. Something using the new cards, of course. Spirited Companion. All right, unexpected. So still looking for a little blue mana. All right, I think I should not attack because I don't want to give them a free attack to get a draw off the wedding announcement if that's what they want. I'll probably just pass with the intent to discard a Corpse Appraiser to the blood token I guess I could do that now in case I draw like an Enters the Battlefield tapped land or another Blood Tithe Harvester. Sure. Okay, well, that's a good target for Go for the Throat at least. And yes, this is indeed a brew using some new cards. All right. So is it time for Fable? Is it time for Corpse Appraiser or Shouldred? I would say not Shouldred because I want to hit my fifth land for the Invoke Despair next turn. So maybe I'll go with Fable. And I'll still be on the no attacks plan. Spirited Companion is nice because this can insulate them as an enchantment against Invoke Despair. All right, Invasion of Segovia. So this gives two tokens, gives their stuff Convoke if they're able to transform. I might just stand pat here. I think my cards are all stronger than a randomly selected card would be. Yeah, I think I want to just play Invoke Despair on back-to-back turns. Well, I guess what if I start by attacking with the Goblin Shaman? No, because they'll block with the Bank Buster. I think playing Shouldred is like a little too weak because they're just pretty likely to have a removal spell, you know, Ossification or whatever it might be. It would be nice if I still had my blood token to get the companion with the Blood Tithe Harvester and then guaranteed kill Wedding Festivity with Invoke Despair. But alas, I did decide to cash in my blood token earlier to try to find a land drop. Oh, wow, they just voluntarily sacrificed the wedding announcement? I thought for sure they were going to sack the companion and then have all these 2/2s that could profitably attack the battle. But instead, oh man, do they have the Convoke card drawing spell? Because that would have them drawing 7 cards here, which is... All right, my opponent typed in the chat, totally forgot Spirited Companion. So we'll have to see what happens. So is this an opponent who's likely to have board sweepers? Maybe start with Corpse Appraiser this time. Okay. Well, at least I'm glad I chose to double spell instead of just spending my whole turn on either Shouldered or Invoke Despair. A competitive game, like they get to go to town with the Bank Buster, but they do have to answer the reflection of Kiki Jiki in some form. Okay, they're going to draw on their main phase. So I'm going to start by sending in the Goblin Shaman. If I could just get a treasure and a fair trade, then that's good for me. I'll probably want to copy a Blood Tithe Harvester and eventually kill the Spirited Companion to make Invoke Despair more powerful. But I think right off the bat, this is just attack. Probably play Shouldred and pass the turn. Though let's see if they have like Wandering Emperor or something that could definitely change my play. All right, gonna play Shouldred and pass with Reflection. Wedding announcement. Okay, so now I'm liking the plan of Blood Tithe Harvester on Spirited Companion and Invoke Despair. Gonna start by attacking with Goblin Shaman. Next. Kill the Spirited Companion. So if they have Protecting the Negotiators, they can go counter unless I pay 8. Yeah, there's just no way I'm getting anywhere close to that. So let's see if you have another counter spell. Hey, it worked. I've drawn Make Disappear, which could wind up being helpful. What's this? Everything attacks invasion of Segovia. Iganjo targets Reflection of Kiki-Jiki, yeah. So I will respond by making another Blood Tithe Harvester. So you can counter the transformation of a battle, but you know, my opponent has plenty of mana available, and I think I can just let this go for one turn and then kill it with a harvester. Notably, not an enchantment. This battle is not an enchantment on either side. So this I could counter, and I guess I might as well, like, sack one treasure and this token that's going to be dying anyway. Just because I feel like I'm going to lose my opportunity to make use of that, make disappear. All right, I think first things first. Well, let's think about if they have Protect the Negotiators. I have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, possibly up to 9 mana. I can kill 2 creatures. That's still them able to counter the Invoke Despair with Protect the Negotiators. However, if they have Make Disappear in their deck, attacking with the Goblin Shaman first, it will be profitable for me. So let's start with take out this Kytus. That's also just a scary card because they could have an instant that they're able to convoke out. Crew the Bankbuster. So now I'll probably just go ahead and kill that Bankbuster. What's this? They are casting the last card in their hand. Wandering Emperor. So that's actually quite good for me because it makes Invoke Despair even slightly more profitable. And then 0 cards left for opponent. Takanuma can get me back Shouldered or Corpse Appraiser, so that's pretty nice. Now I'm going to trade off the Harvester against the Bankbuster, get a clean attack with the Goblin. And then if my opponent doesn't draw something pretty special pretty quickly, I think I've fought to a winning position. Interesting. Do I want to cash in 2 treasures for an activation of Bankbuster? I think the answer is no. All right. Shouldred or Corpse Appraiser? I think I'm leaning towards Shouldred, though, with the tiebreaker being that I do have this Reckoner Bankbuster already for more action. But in a spot like this, you know, either creature you're super happy with. I'm going to crew the Bankbuster and attack. It seems like they're going to have a lot of pressure to block with the farmhand. Otherwise, it just cuts their number of draw steps by so much. Yep. And by the way, they do have one card in hand, but it's just the plains that they found off the farmhand. Yep, where that came from. All right, draw for turn. Tons of removal spells, none of which are particularly potent on this board state. Sure, so I'll just go ahead and attack with Shouldred. I know that I'm leaving a slight vulnerability to like my opponent drawing Wandering Emperor, but usually I just, you know, like I know they don't have it in their hand now, so I usually just play to the board rather than worrying about specific top decks. Draw from Bankbuster. Attack for four. Play a Harvester. Wow, I didn't realize quite how long this game had gone. I used half my chess clock just on game number one, so I'll have to be aware of that going later in the match. All right. So my thinking is that spot removal, like cut down and go for the throat, are probably a little weak, though I do want to have some answers to Elesh Norn. A Braid may be fine because they have Bankbuster. So this would give me five answers to Elesh Norn. Let's throw in one go for the throat. And then I think Negate is quite strong. Make Disappear and Disdainful Stroke are like maybes. Corpse Appraiser, I could see going down to like one copy. Harvester's fine, but could trim. Trim on Shouldred, could trim on Invoke Despair. How do I feel about Hidetsugu and Kairi? So they, this, since they're a two-color deck, they may not have laid down arms, but they probably do have ossification or whatever equivalent. Also, they have counter spells, so I don't necessarily want to just have all my most expensive cards. All right, so like, considering these as the maybes. All right, no to make disappear. Yes to one corpse appraiser. And then kind of just throwing in a little sprinkling here and there. I don't know. Let's try it. Excellent opening hand. Notably, my second land drop will enter tapped, but I'm fine to just go like turn two Duress, turn three Fable. That's a great start. I will Duress you. Fateful Absence, I don't care much about that. Invasion of New Phyrexia. Alright. Yeah, I'll take that. And then Mondrak Glory Dominus. That's the second time in this league I'll have played against that card. It's pretty scary. But I got the Soul Transfer ready to go this time. Boo! That's a big swing for them to have drawn the Protect the Negotiators there. So here's Mondrak. I imagine I'll just have to spend my turn soul transferring that. So one Fateful Absence and one mystery card in hand. Time for Fable. And I don't want them to just kill this right away, but I don't think that that's super likely. But I guess, like, well, okay, if I play the Bank Buster, then I can draw a card before Fable Chapter 2 and, like, dig even deeper. I could choose to discard this Fable Chapter 2. All right. That's not obvious to me whether I should play Bloodtithe Harvester or Reckoner Bank Buster in this spot, but I'm going to choose the Bank Buster. All right, more tokens, just one Fateful Absence in hand. All right, so draw step, and then you can always consider if you want to use the Bankbuster in response here. I don't like. I really don't care about this Fateful Absence. I think I'm likely to discard the Duress. I will go ahead and draw a card. And then dump the Duress and the Blackcleave Cliffs. I'm going to choose to play Swamp this turn because I anticipate either wanting to crack a clue from Fateful Absence if they point it at the Blood Tithe Harvester, or maybe I'll want to use Go for the Throat. There's also the consideration of like cycling Xander's Lounge, which that might happen. Given the Bank Buster in play, I never mind just playing out another tapped land, but you know, it's one additional consideration. So they're really holding on to the Fateful Absence. They don't want to be dead to Shouldred, but I'm just kind of burying them in value at this point. Or I guess they just want a Fateful Absence, the reflection of Kiki Jiki, because yeah, that's gonna be the scariest creature. I'll hold on to my Go for the Throat in case they draw Elesh Norn. I think if I can find like Negator Disdainful Stroke, this game will be pretty locked up. Currently no creature in the graveyard, which was definitely a concern, and that's why I went down to one Corpse Appraiser after sideboarding. But what I can do is I can kill a Kraken token, play the Corpse Appraiser, option to crew Bankbuster. Let's start there. And then, like, sometimes I would want to not crew the Bankbuster into the known Fateful Absence, but they have so much pressure to kill the Reflection anyway that I'll put them in a tough spot. Hard to mess this one up, but like I said, I think if I have the negate, it's just, that's going to be all over. And notably, my plan is to not negate the Fateful Absence. Yep. Just value them with the Bank Buster. That's interesting. Yeah, it has four defense, so I can crew the Bank Buster, play this, and then defeat the battle right away. Be my first time transforming this battle. It's pretty cool. Invasion of Karsis. And then whenever I cast any spell, it deals 2 damage to the opponent. That's pretty brutal. Like, next turn, they're going to take 8 plus 4, plus if I draw another creature, I create a Bank Buster. All right, I'll be back for match number 4. Cruising along here. All right, friends, currently 3-0 with Grixis, and here I am for round number 4. My hand is slow but keepable. You know, that cut down really saves the day here, where I can have all my mana and some top end and at least one cheap defensive play, but certainly hoping to draw like a Fable or a Bank Buster to kind of bridge the gap a little more effectively. Drawn Bank Buster. So now the question is, do I kill off the recruitment officer or save the cut down for something a little more scary? This thing is going to deal me a lot of damage, but I think I should probably... it's tough. Like, if they attack, I take 2, and then they play Thalia. What's my plan going to be? I untap, spend my turn 2, cutting down Thalia. See, it's not even really that different. I think I'm just going to try to keep my life total high and cut down this first creature. Invasion of Gobakan. All right. Nice. Very helpful to draw something I can cast there. Yep. So if I want, I can trade off against the Skrelv. Probably not necessary. Just hang on to the Harvester for future use. And I am drawing well. Like, every turn, my opponent takes away my play with Invasion, and I just draw something to play anyway. So I'm definitely running hot here. It's not going to work out well for them. Yes. So they were going to like attack into the Blood Tithe Harvester, maybe with a Skrelv activation, but then they realized I could just block with the Bank Buster, and they, I think, conceded out of frustration. So, yeah, I mean, I ran hot. My draw was good. I had everything I needed to beat a White Weenie beatdown draw. So now bringing in probably just everything that kills a creature. Cutting clunky stuff like Make Disappear, Invoke Despair, Invasion of Tark. Kaldheim is probably not where I want to be, although if I could transform this, just kill everything by discarding lands. Then Bank Buster is a little clunky too. So these are the cards that I'm relatively happy with. And then my last card, I think I want it to be an action card of some kind. Like maybe one Bank Buster, one Invoke. Problem is they could have the Surge of... by the way, I was calling it Surge of Righteousness in a previous match. So it's actually called Surge of Salvation. But if they have access to that, then Invoke Despair is really crummy. So one Bank Buster. One blade coil. I mean, Bankbuster could even be better than Hidetsugu and Kyrie. Maybe two Bankbusters, one dragon. Let's try it. I imagine this matchup's going to be comfortable after sideboarding with the three Lithomantic Barrages. And my hand is pretty good. You know, if they have a one drop and a Thalia, then it's a little tough on me. Also, this dynamic of having Go for the Throat against Skrelv is no fun. Yep, that's the scary opening for sure. Okay, so Cut Down can hit the Skrelv, or I could just play Blood Tithe Harvester, which can also next turn hit the Skrelv. I'm going to do that. Notably, Cut Down cannot hit the Thalia. Yep. So let's say, for sake of argument, there's really no good options for them here because, like, I can't cast Go for the Throat or Fable next turn into their board, but if they... Well, actually, I can just Go for the Throat because the Blood Tithe Harvester kills the Skrelv. And then if they target the Thalia, I respond with Go for the Throat. So like, I'm going to have a great play no matter what, which is kind of the downside of a card like Invasion of Gobakan, is if you can't actually like make them miss a play, then it loses a lot of its effectiveness. I don't even know what I would do if I was in their spot. Like, maybe just take... Sure, yeah, there's no good option. Sure. So Harvester kills Skrelv, and then I play Corpse Appraiser. Just take, I think, the cheapest card. Right, so
I use Weather Underground as my weather app.
two mana to barrage Thalia, and then have two mana open for Go for the Throat. It's probably a reasonable play. Lithomantic Barrage is a sorcery, just for the record. Then they cannot activate Coven, so at face value I could just trade against these creatures. All right, what's it going to be? I mean, if there's no good attack, then I get to play the Fable, and eventually the game goes long enough that I can just access these cards anyway. Only one card in hand remaining for the opponent. Yep, I will block. So, either, you know, like, I'm totally comfortable just blocking Mistress Foundry with my Fable token. Course Brazier does it slightly better. I don't think that really matters here. I'm going to play Fable. Yeah, I think I'm just comfortable with the cards that I have. Swing with Goblin. I'm going to cast the expensive Corpse Appraiser. Just to, like, guarantee to use my mana. Grab the untapped land. So now I have... Oh, no, I don't have... Oh, wow. That was not good. I was thinking that this cost me two. Like, I was... My mind was in the taxed by Thalia mode, but it actually cost me three. So taking the Sulphur Springs didn't really make sense. I should have taken this cut down, which I actually could have used for one mana. Yep. So start with Corpse Appraiser. All right, my opponent's seen enough. Okay, 4-0. That means next one will be for all the marbles. Don't go anywhere. All right, everybody, 4-0 with Grixis Midrange, which means this one is for all the marbles, playing for the league trophy. I'm not going to mulligan this hand, but I am on the draw with no play until turn three, so there are some ways that it could go, it could get ugly, but, you know, that's part of the cost of doing business, I think. And yes, this is one of the ways it could get ugly. Is an Abzan. I was gonna say maybe an Abzan toxic deck, but the Thalia maybe just like an Abzan disruptive creature deck. Probably, I mean, my best way to win this game is just like hope they don't have an answer to Shouldred. Okay, so basically Malira can save another creature. Okay, I will make the only play I can make, which is just throwing a Corpse Appraiser out there as a 3-3. Notably, no land drop from the opponent, so maybe that will wind up being the little reprieve that I need to stabilize. Okay, so my instinct is just to block, right? This can't actually save their creature, so happy to just trade 3-3 against 3-3, keep my life total high. Yep, makes perfect sense. So, Shouldred, Fable. It's gotta be Shouldred. Like, if I play Fable, I'm just taking 5 damage no matter what. Alright. Shouldred's alive. Now I can just kind of sit around with Make Disappear. My opponent's taken a lot of damage from their pain land so far. Is there any way I can attack? No, I don't think so. So yeah, here I like passing with just Make Disappear or cycling land. Oh, Shouldred. There are a lot of cool, fancy new cards for March of the Machine, but Shouldred the Apocalypse is still not outclassed. So, what are they representing here? Like, Iganjo would be bad for me because I can't counter it. Not blocking at all seems a little unreasonable. I mean, if I just take 8, I go to 11, then I draw a card up to 13, I attack my opponent. If I block the Malira and they play Iganjo, or they channel Iganjo, then we make the trade. I'm at 14. I get a fresh draw from the cycling, a fresh draw from my draw step. I think I'm going to block. You'd have to go through this whole thought process of like what happens if they have Iganjo, but then you'd also have to give them credit for having Iganjo in a game where they've missed their land drop every turn. So like, yes, they could have drawn it this turn. I'm not sure I really believe that they had it in a previous turn. So reasonable chance that they're just desperate and bluffing. Who knows? Seju. More Maliras. Just counter that because make Disappear is super clunky and I want to spend my mana while I can. Ooh. Double Shouldred. So worst case scenario is like they sack their Thalia, then they make a fourth land draw, play Wandering Emperor. But even then, like this is just a lethal creature with menace. So far, so good. I'm going to sideboard pretty similarly to how I sideboarded against the White Weenie deck, which is just cut the clunky stuff, bring in everything that kills a creature. So I think this is what I did last time, which seems fine. Like, yeah, the second Bank Buster is definitely a marginal option. Or I could see having one of these bigger cards. But we'll try it. I like the nice lean configuration for when I'm on the draw, and then if we go to game three, I can reevaluate. Yeah, that's not the winner. Do not want to keep the one lander against the Thalia deck. This is much more my speed. My only complaint is that I can't keep all seven cards, but how about just keeping two removal spells and a Corpse Appraiser? Play the tapped land, because holding up cut down is not even effective against a lot of their two drops. Like, doesn't work against Thalia, doesn't work against Malira. It does work against that, but it's just not very exciting. Okay, I think I'm going to go with tapped land and then, like, take three. I don't know, maybe I just kill this right away, because they can't return it yet. Alright, yeah, I'll just deal the one damage to it. Or no. I imagine the barrage kills more than the cutdown does. So just main phase, cutdown, play a tapped land. And then try to nab that with Corpse Appraiser, so it's not a problem later. So it's the fourth land that really worries me. I'm going to play Corpse Appraiser and then try to double spell with the barrage on a later turn. Could be like really sketchy play, because letting Adeline spiral out of control is definitely a way to lose here. Since I already have a 5-drop, I'm going to take a Corpse Appraiser. Just face value next turn, fourth land Barrage Corpse Appraiser looks like a great play. They have the Plaza of Heroes, but I don't know if they can really afford to just sit on Plaza without playing anything. Well, that's what they're going to do. All right, well, you want to sack your land? I guess I can, yeah. I mean, there's no bad outcome here. I can go for the throat, or I could just play another Corpse Appraiser. Think I'm just going to let that happen and play another Corpse Appraiser. Gotta just take another barrage. So good here. Okay, this time it's gonna be soul transfer. No, maybe it's going to be barrage and cut down and hold up, go for the throat. The rare opportunity to cut down an Adeline. Now, like, my opponent trying to scramble back when they're behind on the board and have sacrificed two lands. Sure. Almost any draw is going to be really good here. Like, fifth land is great. A card I can play is great. Ayo the Dawn Sky. Man, I've got the soul transfer all lined up. It's just perfect. So that's going to be me attacking for 9 and scoring the 5-0. Yeah, Obliterating Bolt even better. All right, friends. 5-0 with Grixis Midrange. It's a tried and true deck with a couple of really sweet new cards sprinkled in. So if you're looking for something to play in the early days of new standard, this is a great option. I'll see you next time.